10, 9, 8.
Side booster ignition.
6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0. Ignition.
Is supersonic. Side boosters are now throttling back up to full power.
Vehicle has reached maximum dynamic pressure.
We're past max Q, the period of maximum loads on the vehicle. Next up, we'll be waiting for the side boosters to begin to throttle down prior to booster engine cutoff and separation 2.5 minutes into flight. GNC trajectory looks good on the Falcon Heavy. Reports show that the M1D engine performance is nominal.
Contact engine sales begun.
Side boosters have begun to throttle down in preparation for the upcoming shutdown in 20 seconds. Major event coming up with side booster shutdown and separation.
Inside shutdown. Side boosters. Vehicle. Center. Booster's halfway there. We're throttling up. S1 keeps going. Still booster or boost box setting.
Successful separation. We're coming up on Miko in shutdown.
They have recognition. This big burn looks good inside boosters.
Back from startup.
Coming up on bearing separation.
Center core side engines on power also look good.
Oh, any David Bowie fans? Space Oddity? I mean, I don't know about you all. I have goosebumps. I'm missing these space shuttles. This is the rocket. Ladies and gentlemen, you are looking at the most powerful rocket in operation in the world today. That is what we are witnessing thanks to Elon Musk and SpaceX. You know, he wants to take people up to Mars, but this so far, in terms of a rocket, has been a success. Look at that crowd looking upwards and applauding. There they are. Let's go to Miles O'Brien, first of all, who you know, knows all things space. And, I mean, a huge moment, obviously, for Elon Musk and SpaceX. What's the goal here?
The goal right now, Brooke, is for me to get my composure. I'm a little misty. This is an emotional moment. I'm like you on this. I've missed greatly launches of the shuttles. I never had the opportunity to see in person a launch of a Saturn V. I wish dearly I was in Florida today, but couldn't get there. You know, looking at that crowd, one of the things that really strikes me is if you think about how the United States got to the moon, it was on the backs and the brains of 20-somethings, really smart young people. Look at that crowd there in Hawthorne, California, the SpaceX team. It's a new generation of space travelers and explorers that are putting this amazing rocket into space, and really, in so many ways, a game changer for ultimately exploring space in a more sustained way. So this is a big moment.
And Leroy Chow, I've got you also, a retired NASA astronaut, also, I imagine, equally misty-eyed, talking about SpaceX's Falcon Heavy rocket there and the successful launch. What are you thinking as you watch that go up, up, and away?
Well, I tell you what, I am pretty overcome. This is fantastic. This is the first time in a very long time we've launched a rocket. Anyone has launched a rocket that's this powerful. And watching it fly away, it looks like everything's still going nominally. Of course, we're not out of the woods. We've still got the upper stages continuing to burn, and we're all watching that. But the first stages look flawless. Everything looked great. As Miles was saying, you know, that crowd of young people out in Hawthorne is just really inspiring. I think this is an important moment for exploration, and that's what's really unique is you have visionaries like Elon Musk who want to put their own profits into exploring space, and that's why this rocket is being built and flown. It's got much, much capacity to just launch a satellite. So this is a big moment.
And we should also point out, I mean, I think people are being also, you know, this is an incredible moment, but more lighthearted. There are no Leroy Chows on board, you know, the Falcon Heavy rocket, Miles. This is what they call there's a dummy payload on board. You know, there's a hunk of metal. In fact, it's my understanding that Elon Musk actually put up his own Tesla Roadster as part of this launch in this rocket. Is that right?
That is right. That's a used Tesla that Elon himself drove with a, you know, essentially a crash test dummy. I would certainly never call my friend Leroy a dummy, but this is a substitute astronaut for now. I mean, what they do typically on space tests like this, what NASA would do, is put ballast in there, a hunk of concrete or something, just to give it some weight. And part of what I appreciate is the enthusiasm and the tweaks and the sense of humor, and frankly, for Elon, the cross-promotional benefits of putting a Tesla in orbit for a billion years around the sun and near Mars.
And by the way, I've got one more voice, Rachel Crane, who's actually there, lucky, lucky fellow space geek, who's there taking it all in, jumping up and down. I feel your enthusiasm jumping in front of the camera. Rachel, talk to me and tell me also about these boosters.
Right. Well, Brooke, we did just see two boosters coming down moments ago, but the entry burn was shut down. We don't see them anymore, but I do hear people cheering around me. There's a couple buildings, so it's blocked. Oh, there's a sonic boom. Woo! So, wow. Brooke, if I can't even begin to describe the excitement around me. I mean, everybody's come out from
the
buildings
the camera,
here at
Rachel.
Kennedy Space Center.
Pan the camera over.
Can you guys turn the camera over to see it? Sorry, Brooke,
there's a building
right in the way of seeing this, these incredible landings. Unfortunately, I can't see them myself, but to describe feeling this launch here at Kennedy Space Center, this historic launch of Falcon Heavy, I mean, this is one for the books. Brooke. It was really, truly incredible. Yesterday, I spoke with Elon Musk. He was, you know, running through all the things that could possibly go wrong here. He said that he would consider it a success if the rocket just simply cleared launch pad 39A. Of course, this is a historic launch pad. This is where, you know, Apollo 11 sent humans to the moon. But had it been destroyed with this launch, it also would have delayed all their further launches. They said that Falcon Heavy could be ready to relaunch in 3 to 6 months. Of course, that would have been delayed if the launch pad was destroyed. As we saw today, it was successful. It was not destroyed. So that will not be a problem. But we're waiting to see just how successful it was. You know, as you were just speaking with Miles, there is his own personal Tesla Roadster on board with that, you know, that space dummy on there playing David Bowie Space Oddity. We don't know exactly how far it's gotten at this point, but we will keep you updated as we get all of this incredibly exciting space information. Brooke.
I love the enthusiasm. Rachel Crane, my friend, thank you so much. I've still got Miles O'Brien and Leroy Chow with me. And so, Miles, just back over to you. Where exactly is the rocket going?
It's going in a what they call a highly elliptical orbit, and it orbits actually around the sun, and it will sort of meet up, you know, kind of racetrack style, merging with Mars on occasion. So it's about 250,000 miles at its farthest distance from Earth. So it's a pretty decent stretch of the way to Mars. You know, obviously not entering Mars orbit or landing on Mars, but that Tesla Roadster will just be orbiting there for who knows how long, for the eons, with the dummy looking out the window into the void.
Wow. And Leroy, I remember standing down there at Cape Canaveral and watching that final space shuttle take off and just being, you know, thrilled to see it, but also sad and nostalgic. And I mean, here, you know, as an astronaut or a former astronaut, what are the next major steps like today in space exploration?
Oh, absolutely. This is huge. This is a huge deal. It looks like the upper stage has entered a nominal parking orbit. We saw the landing of the two side boosters. We don't know if the third booster has landed yet, but just everything looks flawless. And the next steps are to continue flying this vehicle, getting some more pedigree on it, launching other payloads. And as you know, Elon Musk says he's got two paying customers who want to go around the moon Apollo 8 style. In a Dragon spacecraft, and it would be this rocket that would take them on that way. And that would be a huge deal because, of course, that would be the first commercial vehicle that leaves Earth orbit with passengers, with astronauts on board, you know, that, geez, I mean, ever. So,
yeah.
Pretty neat stuff.
What's the price tag for this kind of thing, and is this all Elon Musk, or is he hoping for the federal government to help out? What's the scoop, Miles?
Well, the first thing to know is the price tag is a fraction of what NASA projects the cost of its comparable rocket, the Space Launch System, will be. And a big part of that is what you just witnessed, the return of those two boosters to the pad, fully reusable, and we hope before not too long, the third booster, which will land significantly downrange and a platform in the sea. It's about 30% of the cost that NASA is projecting for the Space Launch System, and that really is a game changer. You know, we used to say when Leroy was flying the shuttle that it was about $10,000 a pound for any pound of anything you put on the shuttle. Elon Musk is claiming below $1,000 a pound. So we're talking about an order of magnitude here. And that changes everything when you talk about space exploration. So, you know, you have to ask yourself who's going to get to Mars first, NASA or Elon Musk. Huh. Right now, the smart money would be on the guy who puts Teslas in space.